إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، إنه من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. اللهم ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب. اللهم ربنا أعنا على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك. اللهم ربنا لا تؤاخذنا إن نسينا أو أخطأنا. اللهم ربنا ولا تحمل علينا إصرا كما حملته على الذين من قبلنا. اللهم ربنا ولا تحملنا ما لا طاقة لنا به، واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا، أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. اللهم ربنا أفرغ علينا صبرا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. اللهم ربنا اغفر لنا ولإخواننا الذين سبقونا بالإيمان ولا تجعل في قلوبنا غلا للذين آمنوا ربنا إنك رؤوف رحيم. لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إنا كنا من الظالمين. لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إنا كنا من الظالمين. لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إنا كنا من الظالمين. لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، له الملك وله الحمد بيده الخير يحيي ويميت وهو على كل شيء قدير. لا إله إلا الله ولا نعبد إلا إياه مخلصين له الدين ولو كره الكافرون. لا إله إلا الله ولا نعبد إلا إياه مخلصين له الدين ولو كره المشركون. رضيت بالله ربا وبالإسلام دينا وبمحمد صلى الله عليه وسلم نبيا ورسولا. رضينا بالله ربا وبالإسلام دينا وبمحمد صلى الله عليه وسلم نبيا ورسولا. سبحان الله بحمده عدد خلقه ورضا نفسه وزنة عرشه ومداد كلماته. سبحان الله والحمد لله ولا إله إلا الله والله أكبر ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. سبحان الله بحمده سبحان الله العظيم سبحان الله بحمده سبحان الله العظيم سبحان الله بحمده سبحان الله العظيم. لا إله إلا الله وحده أنجز وعده ونصر عبده وهزم الأحزاب وحده. لا إله إلا الله وحده أنجز وعده ونصر عبده وهزم الأحزاب وحده. لا إله إلا الله وحده أنجز وعده ونصر عبده وهزم الأحزاب وحده. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وإن خير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وإنما توعدون لآت وما أنتم بمعجزين. ثم أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. The topic today is about lofty aspirations. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Jalla Jalaluhu, brought us humans to attain something that creations before us, even if they attained it, cannot attain that loftiness which we were given the opportunity to attain. And the greatest potential, you as a man and you as a woman, to attain in this dunya is closeness to Allah Azza wa Jalla Jalalu Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala makes this very clear. The greatest potential in Surah Waqi'a Jalla wa Ala says, والسابقون السابقون, the best of the best who were forerunners in attaining the potential. And then Jalla wa Ala says the achievement which they achieved. He says, أُولَٰئِكَ الْمُقَرَّبُونَ, they are closest to him Jalla Jalalu Subhanahu wa Ta'ala for eternity, for infinite numbers of life with Allah Azza wa Jalla Jalalu Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, whether they be man or woman, whether they were in the generation of Adam alayhi salam, whether they be in the generation that came in the time of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whether they be in the generation that comes after Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or just before the Qiyamah, the greatest potential that every man and woman can attain with Allah Azza wa Jalla Jalalu Subhanahu wa Ta'ala for infinite, for eternity, is to be close with him Jalla Jalalu Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. And not only to be close with him, but to attain your rank and honor and status. To attain your rank and honor and status for eternity in the sight of Allah Azza wa Jalla Jalalu Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, an honor and a rank and a status that never will cease to leave the person, rather it will increase. It will increase for eternity. The question is, how can we attain that closeness with Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala whilst we are in dunya, with all the obstacles that Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala created for us to show our closeness to Him Subhanahu wa Ta'ala? Inshallah, I will go through them one by one, how we can attain that. But before I do that, I want to just go back a bit and speak about when we were souls. Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala says, وَإِذْ أَخَذَ رَبُّكَ مِنْ بَنِي آدَمَ مِنْ ظُهُورِهِمْ ذُرِّيَّتَهُمْ وَأَشْهَدَهُمْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ قَالُوا بَلَىٰ شَهِدْنَا أَنْ تَقُولُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ إِنَّ عَنْ هَذَا إِنَّا لَغَافِلُونَ. Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala says in Surah A'raf that when Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala created Adam alayhi salam, after creating Adam alayhi salam, He tapped the back, struck the back of Adam alayhi salam, and all the souls and all the offsprings came out until Qiyamah of human beings. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked the question, we all know this incident, but the point here I want to make is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He created Adam alayhi salam, and when He creates every creation, this is the key point, is that He embeds and He manifests the rububiyyah attributes of Allah Azza wa Jalla within the soul. He embeds and He manifests the rububiyyah attributes of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala within the soul. And that manifestation, we call it fitrah. And Allah calls it fitrah. With that fitrah, we acknowledge Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala when He asks us the question, أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ, am I not your Rabb? Am I not the being who brought you and all of you into existence and everything into existence and gave you thus far the sustenance to live as a soul within the body of Adam alayhi salam? And am I not the one who will also sustain you for eternity? Our answer was, of course, O my Rabb. قَالُوا بَلَىٰ شَهِدْنَا, we are witness. That is the fitrah within the soul, acknowledging and then affirming the Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with utterance. Affirming the Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with utterance. This Tawheed is the first potential you need to attain in this dunya. This Tawheed, affirming what you feel in your heart, what you feel in your fitrah, Affirming that Tawheed is the first potential you as a human being and you as a creation need to attain, first and foremost. Unless and until you attain that Tawheed therein, every other Tawheed you may attain will have gaps. Will have gaps. And thereby that's the first Tawheed you need to attain, Tawheed of Rububiyyah. First and foremost in your heart, you affirm all the Rububiyyah attributes for Allah Azza wa Jalla. And then, without the knowledge, you don't have to have the wahi knowledge. Without the knowledge, whatever the fitra dictates for you to affirm for Allah Azza wa Jalla, you affirm in your action. Whether you know the words to utter or not. For example, in your heart, in the fitra, it says that there's one being. Now you don't have to utter the shahada. That's the shahada, the wahi that teaches you to say La ilaha illallah. You don't have to utter that shahada. You can say with your own words in English or in Bengali or whichever language you're from. You can say there is only one Allah who is deserving of worship. Or I only show my ultimate love and appreciation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is tawheed in utterance, in your own words. Here you affirm tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of rububiyyah, or that Allah is my creator, or Allah is the creator of all creation and I'm returning back to Him. And I'm only accountable to Him and I will have to answer to Him only and nobody else. Here you're affirming Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of the fitrah, which the fitrah is dictating and telling you. That is the first potential all of us has to attain. Has to attain. Fitrah manifests all the rububiyyah attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we can attain all the Tawheed of rububiyyah of Allah azza wa jalla by utterance. And then by actions. Obviously the perfection of that, the wahi dictates it. The perfection of the ibadat, of the fitrah, the wahi dictates it, wahi legislates it. But before that, you can affirm. For example, appreciation. You can affirm appreciation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and gratitude for Him creating you and sustaining you and giving you ability to live and sustain with your family and giving you the ability to breathe, for example. You can appreciate, you can say, oh Allah, thank you for the ability, the easiness for me to breathe. You can thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, affirm tawheed therein, and so forth. That is the first stage. Ibrahim alayhi salam attained that first stage while he was a young boy in the midst of kufr and shirk in a society which they went against the fitrah, not against the wahi, because wahi did not come to these people yet. Ibrahim alayhi salam will bring the wahi to them. The wahi that came before Ibrahim was well gone. Only some remnants were left. So they went against the kufr and shirk of the fitrah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes people into account when they go against the fitrah wahi and the aql and the conscience wahi. Conscience fitrah. When they go against that, Allah takes them account. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punishes people in terms of when they go against the fitri dictation. The fitri dictation. So, for example, when a person is oppressive, is cruel, Allah takes them into account. Allah Jalla wa'ala takes them into account. Wahi doesn't have to say to you, don't be cruel, don't be oppressive, and then Allah comes and takes you into account. La. If you're cruel, even to a cat, even to an animal, it's in the fitrah that says, don't be cruel to the animal, don't be cruel to anyone, don't be oppressive. Don't take out that's right. It's in the fitrah. You know that in your aql. And thereby, once you be cruel, once you be oppressive, Allah will take into account, whether irrespective of whether you're Muslim or not, and irrespective of whether you know the specific text that says don't be oppressive or you don't. Allah will take you into account. So first and foremost, Ibrahim alayhi salam here, he attained the tawheed of rububiyyah of Allah azza wa jalla. I affirmed all the attributes of rububiyyah that the fitrah affirms for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he manifested that tawheed with his actions. Then he must manifested the tawheed of rububiyyah with his actions. He began to call his people, began to call his father, began to call and speak about this tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and negate every other attribute that people were attributing to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and committing kufr and shirk therein. That's why Ibrahim alayhi salam was called Imam of Hunafa. Imam of Hunafa. In other words, attaining the tawheed of the fitrah makes you Hanif. So that statement one more time. attaining the Tawheed al-Rububiyyah makes you called Hanif, Hunafa. And Ibrahim al-Islam was given that title, being Imam. Why? Because everyone around him did not have that fitrah Tawheed. He had it by himself alone. He attained it by himself alone without anyone asking him, without anyone advising him, without anyone teaching him, before even the wahi was revealed to him. That's the first potential each one of us has to attain. When we attain that potential, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in various verses, I don't go through all the verses, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says in a very nice hadith, we have khayriya within us. We have khayriya within us. Meaning everything else, once we attain that fitrah tawheed, everything around us we do becomes khayr for us. And khayr, the word khayr is mutaaddi, meaning that you not alone benefit yourself, you start benefiting others. When you become a person of khayr, everything you do, from your intentions, minute, hidden, secretive intentions you do, it becomes a means and a ways of benefiting others, whether you know it, whether you don't. It becomes a ways and means of benefiting others. That's what the khayr embeds ta'addi, i.e. it's multiple benefit beyond yourself. Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, خَيْرُكُمْ فِي الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ خَيْرُكُمْ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ إِذَا فَقْهُ. In other narration, خِيَارُكُمْ فِي الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ خِيَارُكُمْ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ إِذَا فَقْهُ. Sahih Bukhari, Sahih Muslim hadith, both Bukhari and Muslim. Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says that the best of you in Jahiliyyah, i.e. best of you before the wahi was sent to you, i.e. the fitrah and the conscience. And they are linked. Maybe in other time I can explain them, the difference between the fitrah and the conscience and the aql and all of that, but they're interconnected. Fitrah is in the heart, aql is in the brain, in the mind, and then the conscience is the peak of the mind. Conscience is the peak of the mind. In Allah calls that lub, ulul albab, or he calls it ulul absar, and that's in the mind. That's the conscience. It's got a connection with the fitrah. طيب, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, says, خِيَارُكُمْ فِي الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ خِيَارُكُمْ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ إِذَا فَقْهُ. The best of you in jahiliyyah, i.e. before the wahi came, you were jahil in terms of perfection of your khayr deeds. That's what jahiliyyah means. I'm giving a definition here. Jahiliyyah means you are ignorant to perfect your inner and outer khayr deeds. You're ignorant, and thereby you are jahil. خِيَارُكُمْ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ خِيَارُكُمْ فِي الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ خِيَارُكُمْ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ. You are best in Islam. Islam came and perfected that khayriya. Perfected for eternity. For every generation, for every space, for every place, for every time, for every age. Everyone. Everyone's included. خِيَارُكُمْ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ خِيَارُكُمْ فِي الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ خِيَارُكُمْ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ إِذَا فَقُهُ. As long as you attain the depth knowledge of Islam. Because depth knowledge of Islam has nothing but, and remember this word, depth knowledge of Islam has nothing but structure of life. One more time. The depth knowledge of Islam has nothing but structure of life. Meaning, in other words, it makes you attain the best, I said that again, it makes you attain the best of this life and the next life in a very quick, efficient manner. In a very quick, efficient manner. Makes you attain the best of this life, the peak of this life, and the peak of next life for eternity in the quick, efficient manner. خِيَارُكُمْ فِي الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ خِيَارُكُمْ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ إِذَا فَقْهُ. It gives you a structure. Why? Because before the wahyi, your structure has no end. Before the wahi, your structure has no end. You may have a structure in the fitrah. You may have a structure in the aql. You may have a structure in the conscience. You may have a structure. But that structure doesn't have an end. It doesn't have perfection. And thereby the wahi comes and gives the end. It gives the end goal. It gives the end purpose. It gives the end mindsets and signposts for you to attain step by step, stage by stage, phase by phase, need basis, importance basis, and eventually priority basis. Again, phase, need basis, important basis, priority basis. It gives you a structure within you by which you unite yourself and you don't be disunited within yourself. By which you unite yourself so that you don't become disunited within yourself, so you become destructured and dysfunction when it comes to your life, by which then it gives you an obstacle and it prevents you from attaining your potential of this life and potential of the hereafter. So first and foremost, I give you the structure again. First and foremost, attain the tawheed of the fitrah first. That's your first potential you need to attain. If you have not attained that, you will find, I'll say that again, a key statement. If you have not attained the fitrah tawheed, you will not be able to attain the wahi tawheed in some aspects. If you have not attained the fitrah tawheed, you'll not be able to attain the wahi tawheed in some aspects. I'll give you an example. Fitrah tells you to be consistent and constant in any deed you do. Fitrah tells you. Wahi doesn't tell you that. Wahi comes and tells you afterwards. But fitrah tells you anything good, you need to be constant and consistent therein. In our lives, if I ask you, are you consistent in your salah? That's the wahi. Are you consistent in your siyam? That's the wahi. Are you consistent in your good behavior and character? That's the wahi telling you. Are you consistent? These are wahi telling you to do all this. Are you consistent in your sadaqat? Are you consistent in your qiyamul layl? Are you consistent in your recitation? Are you consistent in inviting the mu'mineen and the muttaqeen? Are you consistent to classes? Are you consistent in memorizing? Are you consistent in the bond with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Are you consistent in your secretive ibadat? Wahi tells you to be consistent in this ibadat. But before that, the fitrah tells you. And the question is, if the fitrah is telling you to be consistent, and if the wahi also tells you clearly, explicitly to be consistent, and it enforces in many ways, in many angles for you to be consistent, the question is, why are we, as Muslims, not being consistent? Whether it is a matter to attain the matters of dunya, or whether it is a matter to attain the akhirah life. Why are we not consistent? What's the main defect? Is it sincerity? Or is it something more deeper than sincerity? That comes before sincerity itself. It's something more deeper. And so Allah made that very clear. He says, أَحَبُّ الْأَعْمَالِ إِلَى اللَّهِ أَدْوَمُهَا وَإِنْ قَلَّ أَحَبُّ الْأَعْمَالِ إِلَى اللَّهِ أَدْوَمُهَا وَإِنْ قَلَّ The most beloved deed to Allah Azza wa Jalla subhanahu wa ta'ala is a consistent deed even if the quantum is few and little. We are not consistent because we're not obeying our fitrah first and foremost. So even if the wahi comes and tells you, be consistent, we'll not be able to be consistent because we are not listening to the fitrah in the first place. And this goes across the board. If you're slacking in your salah, if you're slacking in your siyam, if you're slacking in being consistent in classes, if you're slacking in any ibadat, or any attainment and achievement that you want to attain in the dunya or the akhirah, is because there's something gone wrong in the fitrah. Aslan, at foundation level. And thereby it's important to revisit our fitrah. Reawaken it. Revisit. And I'll tell you something that's very important. Note this key statement down. Every khair the non-Muslims have achieved from day one, and every khair the non-Muslim will achieve until Qiyamah. They have achieved it, and they will achieve it due to the fitrah, not due to the wahi. They don't know the wahi. They don't follow the wahi. Even if the wahi tells them, they will not obey it. So every khair, everything you see here, they built, and they made, and they invented. And every charity they have, true charity, is all due to the fitrah dictating them to do so. It's all due to the conscience that's telling them and dictating them to do so. So if we Muslims have the fitrah, and yet we have not built any of this, yet we have not invented any of this, that means we are not obeying our fitrah first and foremost. Second, when the wahi tells us to build, and to invent and to create and to establish and to give charity, establish efficient organizations to manifest those charities. We're not doing it also. We're not doing it also. So what's going wrong? What's going wrong is at the fitrah level. This fitrah is vast. It's so vast that you can build civilizations. It can build caring systems like the welfare system, based on fitrah. It's all based on fitrah. The Habashi person who became Muslim eventually, Najashi, he ruled his kingdom, some called it justice. What justice was there when there was no Islam? There was no perfect justice, but there was the fitrah justice. There was the conscience justice. He established that, and that's why he became Muslim. This fitrah, when it's established fitrah, attained the tawheed therein, naturally you began to become a Muslim. It pushes you. That's why many people who become Muslim, they say, you know, I was Muslim before Islam. Because it was all there in the fitrah. And thereby, my advice to you, key advice, is that if you are not steadfast in the deen, even though you know the texts and knowledge of the warning and the glad tidings of this ibadah, and you can't be consistent, revisit your fitrah. Revisit your intellect. Intellect meaning revisit the questions. Why am I not consistent? If I know this is a good deed, why am I not performing it? What's wrong with me? What is preventing me? What are the obstacles? Note them down. And remember, one of the key statements, no one is more practical as a human than the Muslims. No one is more practical as a human than the Muslims. And no one can be more proactive as a human than the Muslims. No one can compete for dunya and the akhirah better than the Muslims. That's the reality of the Muslim. We have gone somewhere wrong. So you need to revisit and question yourself. And all of these ibadat, my brothers, that come to you, for example, the hadith of siyam, the hadith of qiyam, the hadith of the verse of Quran of taqwa. Do you know what is Allah's purpose, all of his verses and all of his hadith and all of these ibadat? What's the main goal of Allah Azza wa Jalla? We all say taqwa, to attain taqwa. Okay, if I ask you, what does that mean? What does that mean? Anyone? Let me take a sip of water in the meantime. Sometimes the simplest of questions bring out the profound meanings. Sometimes the simplest of questions, just asking simplest of questions, brings that profound meaning that changes your life. For example, what is taqwa? Everyone gives the definitions. But practically, how will that definition impact me and my life? I'll give you one thing of one of the purposes of different ibadat and any ibadah. One of the main purposes of all of these different ibadat and a ibadah is that you attain peak of your conscience. You attain peak of your conscience by which you consciously are you aware why you're doing something and how you are doing it. I'll say that one more time. Okay, it's important if you can note them down because these are key definitions by which you make yourself practical in a structured manner. Okay, I say again. One of the reasons why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave different types of ibadat and any ibadah, one of the reasons and purpose behind it is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes you attain the peak of your conscience. Yeah? And makes you attain the peak of conscious that you're aware. Aware of what? Aware why you are performing this ibadah. So why goes to your heart, the fitrah, and the wahi, the reasons and intentions and so forth. Why? And not only that, how you are performing it also. Is that clear? Once you know your whys, and once you know your hows, you become united within yourself. I say that again. Once you know your whys, once you know your hows, you become united within yourself. You become one. So your heart doesn't think one way, and your mind is thinking another way. Or your mind wants something, thinks one way, and your heart wants something else. Look, your heart believes in certain things, your mind processes that, your conscience dictates it, and then you go and act in a structured manner. And the most successful people, that's one key statement coming, the most successful people, whether Muslim or not, is that they are structured people. They are unified within themselves. Anyone who has unity within themselves, they will be successful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes that very clear by saying, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. In another verse, دَائِمُونَ. Consistent. They are successful. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ. Success. That's why no one, none of us can be successful, whether in deen or dunya, unless we attain a structure, a unified structure within our hearts and within our minds. And that can't be attained unless you attain the tawheed of fitrah, and then you attain tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in wahy. Let me explain the tawheed of the wahy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Surah Al-Shura, شرع لكم من الدين ما وصى به نوحا والذي أوحينا إليك وما وصينا به إبراهيم وموسى وعيسى أن أقيموا الدين ولا تتفرقوا فيه. This is one of the greatest verses in the Quran. One of the greatest verses in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, شرع لكم من الدين. He gives you the reason why He has legislated this deen. 2 minutes. Subhanallah, Allahu Akbar. I haven't decided my topic. That's his introduction. Subhanallah, Allahu Akbar. I advise you to listen to my development classes online on Arqam. Listen to them. Most of the things I speak about in detail in those development classes. طيب, how can I summarize in one word or one sentence? Our potential after the fitrah in the wahi are two main potentials. First and foremost is the bond between you and Allah, personal bond between you and Allah Azza wa Jalla. That's the first potential you need to attain. That first potential is attained through ibadat dhatiyya. Ibadat which only belong to Allah Azza wa Jalla, nobody else. Like what? Like salah, like siyam, yeah? Like hajj. Tayyib, these are ibadat dhatiyya. Like doing the dhikr of Allah, subhanahu wa alhamdulillah. So these ibadat make you attain the first potential. And the first potential is that you attain a bond with Allah, a personal bond with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For there, you don't have to be a prophet. Maryam attained that, and mother of Maryam attained that. So much so that she had so much confidence asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of something that no one before her asked, and no one after her will ever dare to ask. She said, oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I want to make my child muharrara for you. فَتَقَبَّلْ مِنِّي. Muharrara meaning free from this dunya and just worshipping constantly day in and day out. Allah accept her from me. She made the dua with certitude. And then she said what? Oh Allah, protect me and my child and her offspring from shaitan, especially her offsprings. She asked something with such a confidence with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah granted her. And the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted is amazing. فَتَقَبَّلَهَا رَبُّهَا بِقَبُولٍ حَسَنٍ وَأَنْبَتَا نَبَاتًا حَسَنًا. Allah says, فَتَقَبَّلَهَا. Allah accepted. And Allah says what? فَتَقَبَّلَهَا رَبُّهَا. Her Rabb accepted her dua. Her Rabb. Negating everyone else in that statement. I am only the Rabb for that dua for Maryam. Nobody else. And the mother of Maryam. Allahu Akbar. And Rabb, it means that the one who constantly, whether you know it or not, takes care of you in a subtle, consistent, constant manner. طيب. So that's first.
عبادات ذاتية makes you born of Allah سبحانه وتعالى like the boy and the king Surah Buruj. He attained as a غلام a born of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. He has so much confidence in Allah سبحانه وتعالى that he should say والله اللهم اكفهم كيف شئت بما شئت. Any trial of the dunya, anything huge that came that will kill him, he should say, oh Allah, take care of them, however you wish, with whatever you wish. He needs to leave it to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah's will is to come, and he should say, kun fayakun. He was not a prophet. This is a normal boy. But he attained it through the fitrah tawheed, and then he attained it with the wahi tawheed, whatever he knew. And he didn't know much. So that's the first potential, is the bond to attain the close bond. And the close bond cannot be attained except through tawakkul in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, except through trials and tribulations. Every trial, my sister, and every trial your brother going through, there is an opportunity to attain that bond with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I say that again. Every trial my sister and my brother are going through, there is an opportunity for you to attain the bond with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's a long, lengthy topic as well. I can say another way as well. Every trial you get, it's a means for you to attain tawheed on a specific attribute. I say that again. Every trial you get is a means, an opportunity for you to attain tawheed in a specific attribute of Allah Azza wa Jalla. For example, if you get in trial with your baby, fetus, you're expecting a baby, and you're getting trial, something's wrong with the baby, Allah is trying to make you attain the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Musawwir, the name Al-Musawwir, the name Al-Khaliq, the name Al-Badir. So you call those, Allah, Ya Khaliq, Ya Badir, Ya Musawwir, rectify my child in the womb. I have no control over it. And like this, there's the same thing. Allah is Razzaq, power and authority. Allah is Qadir, Allah is Mawla. So each of this, what happens is you free yourself from the creation, and you perfectly attain that name and that attribute only and solely for Allah Azza wa Jalla. And thereby you attain Tawheed. So much so that you die on your deathbed attaining the Tawheed of 99 names of Allah Azza wa Jalla and more. That's the opportunity you have in every trial you go through. Remember that. That's the person. Last one I'll finish, inshallah. Second is a social Tawheed as an ummah, as a generation. Every generation has the ability to structure attainment of Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a generation, as an ummah. Rasulullah s.a.w. says, إِنَّ هَذِي أُمَّتُكُمْ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً وَأَنَا رَبُّكُمْ فَاعْبُدُونَ. Now the verse, وَأَنَا رَبُّكُمْ فَاتَّقُونَ. Both can be attained as an ummah. Taqwa can be institutionalized and structured. Tawheed and ibadah can be institutionalized and structured. Both can be attained in a society in a structured manner. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in his generation, he attained tawheed at a personal level, and all the sahabas attained the tawheed at a personal level beyond imagination. First. And the second, they attained for their generation as institution. The whole Islam, Tawheed, they attained it and established it as an institution for the generation and generations to come. And they attained the both peak. And thereby they attained the peak of personal Tawheed, and then they attained the peak of social Tawheed. When you attain that, you attain first and foremost the peak of you as a human, when you attain the fitrah Tawheed. And second, when you attain the Tawheed at the personal level, you attain Tawheed, you as a Muslim. And then when you establish Tawheed at a society level, you attain Tawheed as a mu'min. Barakallahu feekum. Jazakumul khair. Subhanakallahu wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.